Okay, so welcome everyone. My name is Stephen McPherson. Welcome to this webinar whereby we're going to be talking about how to image a disk using a Macrium Reflect. I really appreciate your participation today, and hopefully this will last no more than 30 minutes, including my introduction. This series of webinars, of which this is the second, comes from requests from our customers and from our followers, as well as the often asked questions that come through our tech support organization. As mentioned, this is the second webinar in the series, and you can find these on our YouTube channel, which we put up within usually 24 hours of the original recording. The previous one in the series was on how to clone a disk using Macrium Reflect. Today is going to be focused on a demonstration of how to image a disk with Macrium Reflect, as this is the main feature of our software. I have with me Jack Mansfield, who's going to be actually performing the technical demo of the software and doing the imaging process. And I'll be handing over to him for the demonstration midway through this webinar. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to kick off by just quickly looking at Macrium Reflect, what it is. What is disk imaging? I'm going to talk about the differences between imaging and cloning. And I'm going to, and then the demonstration on how to image your disk with Macrium Reflect. And then some other features of the software and upcoming webinars that we'll be doing in this series. So Macrium Reflect has been around for quite a long time. It is our flagship product, a flagship standalone installation for backup of systems and data. And is an image-based backup and cloning solution for commercial and personal use. And we have large numbers of customers who download our software all around the world and are the trial free edition. We have many tens of hundreds of thousands of people who pay to use our software. And with this, you can protect your data, you can use it for upgrading your hard disk, you can clone operating systems, clone data, and many, many, many other things. First of all, before we get into the demonstration side of it, one thing that we quite often get asked about is what is the difference between imaging and cloning? And it's useful to differentiate so that people don't get confused. So as part of that, the definition of imaging so is that Macrium Reflect creates an accurate and complete image of a hard disk and all the partitions on the disk. And we use this through our integration with Microsoft's VSS and its block-based imaging to create an image file, which can then be saved. This means that in the event of a partial or complete system loss, you can use this image to restore the entire disk, partitions, even into files and folders from within that image. So if you're summarizing the differences between cloning and disk imaging, so cloning is a complete volume copy from one to another, including the disks in it and the partitions that are in it, and it is a complete disk to disk. This means that the target disk is going to be identical to the original. Sometimes the partitions are resized automatically based on the available space, but it contains a duplicate of all the volumes involved. It clones the files, operating systems, and applications, everything that's on it, which means that it can be used for DR and is used quite often by technical support organizations that have multiple disks and they can keep cloning from one to the other and then quickly swap out or swap over to the standby disk. Imaging, on the other hand, creates a copy of selected disks or partitions and saves this as an image file. Okay, and this is image file is key to the difference. The image file contains a complete copy of the disk partitions that were imaged, no surprise there, and you can either select or different disks or partitions to be imaged. And then the image file can be mounted independently for file and folder or partition recovery just using Windows Explorer. I'm sure you'll see that. And this means that the image file is mobile, so it can be moved or copied. And it can be used in different places that it was originally made. This is quite different to cloning. So hopefully that gives you some idea of the differences and is clear in what is quite a common question when we get asked, what is the difference between cloning and imaging? When it comes to imaging, the imaging process is the core of the backup process, or the backup features that we have built into Macrium Reflect. So Macrium Reflect can create full differential or incremental images, and this enables you to optimize the backup speed and manage disk space requirements for retention purposes. Usually when you image a volume for the first time, it's called a full image. And a full image file contains all of the data stored in the target volume or disk. So there are two alternative methods for backing up your data after you've done the first full image. This is a differential image, which basically backs up all the data that's changed on the volume since the last full image was taken, irrespective of what was taken since. An incremental image that backs up all the data that's changed on the volume since the last image was taken, whether it was a full, an incremental, or a differential image. So just to repeat, so the differential image backs up all the data that changed on the volume since the last full image was taken, which means that over time they get bigger. Incremental, it just backs up since the last backup of any kind was done. And here we summarize the differences. So differential and incremental images, the advantages and disadvantages. A differential image, it stores the changes that have been made to the file system since the last full image done or full backup. So the advantages of this, it creates, after the initial full is done, differentials can be quick for a short time because the changes are quite small. Obviously, that means that the disk space that is used by the differential image is less than a full, and you can only need two image files to restore the full system. So there's a full and one differential. The disadvantage is that the time since the last image was taken increases, the size of the differential grows. So as I mentioned, the amount of space required becomes more or greater, and as the time progresses since the last full image. This means that it is necessary to perform a full backup occasionally to reduce the size of subsequent differential images, if this is a method that you choose. Incremental images, on the other hand, the main difference with incremental images is that only the changes since the last image, no matter what it was done, what it was, full differential incremental, are identified and stored. The resultant backup set, therefore, will consist of a full and a number of incremental images. And this is managed in different ways, and our software handles all the current methods. The advantages are same as differential images, that the backups are quite small, only changes the stores the last changes since the last full incremental. They're always relatively small and quick to make, and especially if you do them frequently. And this is normally the process. Normally what is used by people to do backups. The disadvantage is that when it comes to a backup set, i.e. what you want to use to do a full recovery, all files must be present in the backup set. So this means that full and subsequent incrementals. That means if any intermediate incremental images are missing, then it's generally not possible to restore the system to the latest image. And there's different tools or different processes that we use for making that, for ensuring integrity and for making that restore process quick. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Jack, and he will fire up his presentation. So Jack, you are now the presenter. If you share your screen, we are ready to go.
Thank you for the introduction. So, as mentioned, we're going to quickly go through the basics of how to create an image. This is one of the first things you'll want to do to get started. Is everyone able to see the screen, first of all?
Yes, it's good. Thanks, Jack.
Okay, so when you first load up Reflect, this is the screen that you'll be presented with. So what we have here is we have a quick breakdown of our connected disks, because this is what we'll want to be imaging. At the side here, we have a little bit of information about the disk, so the file system, the free space, total size. And we have a more graphical version of this as well, which actually shows each partition that is available. From here, we have checkboxes, which allows us to decide what will be included in the image. So the options we have here are image deselected disks on this computer. So I have both disks selected here. So if I do image selected disks, we'll create an image of both of them. If we do create an image of the partitions required to back up and restore Windows, this will only back up the system partitions. So you can tell the system partitions because they have this little icon here. And this is what will need to be backed up to get Windows back up and running again when it's time to restore it. So for example, my secondary disk here is just a data partition and isn't necessary for restoring just to get Windows back up and running. If you select a disk as well, you have a couple of options underneath. We've already covered clone this disk, so this week we'll be covering image this disk. So for this example, I'll just pick my main disk. Here you have an option to select which partitions you want including again. So for this example, we'll just select all partitions. So this will create a full image of that entire disk. So the next step we need to take is choosing where we want this backup to be stored. So using this browse menu, you can select where you want it to be stored. Or if you know the pathway to it, you can just enter it here. Another feature of this is you can select alternate backup, alternate locations. This allows you to add a secondary location in case the first isn't available. So if I add that to the list, here you can then change the order priority. So if I put the second one up, this will be used as the primary storage location. Then if that's unavailable, it will drop down to the next one in the list and so on. So select OK there. Next, we can use a custom name for our image, although it's recommended that you use the image ID as the file name for convenience telling different backup sets apart. If we select next, here is where we decide a schedule for our backups. It is advised that backups are done on a schedule so that you have an up-to-date image in case you do need to recover from disaster. To make this easy, you've got a selection of pre-made backup templates. So for example, we have grandfather, father, son, which is, it'll create a monthly full image, weekly differentials, and an incremental every day. So suppose, however, none of those meet your backup needs, you can also create a custom schedule. So suppose I wanted a full image every Monday at 9 o'clock, select and add that. And then if I wanted incrementals every 2 days, we can do that as well. Following this, we define the retention rules. This ensures that we can manage the available space. It means that our disk doesn't become full at any point. So for this example, we'll keep one full backup. So this means that once this set rule has been exceeded, then the files will either be deleted or consolidated in order to meet this retention rule. So if we have matching backup sets, any backup set which matches the partitions in this one, the retention rules will be applied to. If you want to apply to every backup set, you can select from the drop-down menu, and this will apply your retention rules to every backup set in that location. So next we have purge the backup set if less than a certain amount. So this just ensures that you can set an amount of space on the disk that it won't go below. If the backup's going to exceed this, then the oldest backup set or sets will be purged to make adequate space for the new set. This ensures that the newest backup set is able to be saved. So if we do next, next it'll just show us a breakdown of what's going to be happening. So the partitions that are going to be backed up, the destination, the retention rules, and the schedule. Once you've reviewed all this and you're happy with the selection that you've made, you can select finish. Now, you have the option to run this backup now. We won't select this now because it's on a VM, so it might take a while. And we also have the option to save the backup as an XML file. So this is basically, it contains an outline of all the operations that we're performing now. So the partitions that are going to be backed up. By saving this, it makes it easier to run the backup in the future and to review the options that are being applied. So if we save that. So on the backup definitions menu, as you can see, this is our XML. We can then edit this in the future to change the disks that are being backed up. We can also run the backup manually from here. We can either do a full, differential, or incremental. Bearing in mind that if we don't already have a full image created, incremental and differential will create a full because they'll need to append to that to then back up changes going forwards. Another option we have here is to create a desktop shortcut. This will make it easier in the future to run this backup. Following this, we also have the scheduled backups tab, which just gives a nice breakdown of the backups you've got scheduled. So it'll show you the next runtime, when it was last run, whether it was successful, and who it's being run as. You can also run your backup from here by using the run now function. Select OK on that. So the backup is now running, and we can either show or hide the backup window. So once again, as it's performing this, it will tell us of the progress that's being made and the breakdown of what it's currently doing. Once this is completed, you can navigate to the destination that you selected earlier, and your backup will be completed. With that, I will pass this back to Stephen to continue with the presentation.
Thanks very much, Jack. Really appreciate that. very clear and very concise. It's fair to say that this imaging approach is something which we know is not unique to our own software. However, what we would say is that our integration with the Microsoft tool process which drives us, which is Volume Shadow Copy Services, we believe is the best. And that means that the reliability of the backup process, the consistency of the image, and the recoverability of that backup file is one of the best. And that's what our customers tell us, and what we continue to make sure our products are leading the way in. What we'll do is, I can open now the session to questions. If you want to ask a question, you have two options. One is you can unmute yourself and provide that verbally, and either myself or Jack will pick up the question based depending on how technical it is. Or you can enter the question in the chat on the GoToMeeting dialogue. While we're waiting for questions to come in, there's a whole lot of other features which we will be talking about going in the next webinar series of webinars. We'll be talking about Image Guardian, which is the tool which provides ransomware protection for our backup files. We'll be talking about a virtual image boot, which provides the ability to instantly boot a virtual machine out of one of our backup files. Also talk about more interesting things such as rapid delta cloning, rapid delta restore, which is very interesting for large backup sets, changebot tracking, which we've implemented as in our solutions, and also we'll be talking about the redeploy tool. And this is one of the big advantages of having image-based backup or imaging solutions, is that you can redeploy that image to new or replacement hardware. And this is a major feature of all of our products, and works extremely well. So Jim has asked the question, can the image be a .vdx? By definition, Jim, great question. Thanks very much for that. We have a proprietary format for our image file, which we use, and that is because we have our own encryption algorithms, and we need to be able to control the contents to and from it, or the process to and from that image file. We can be converted through the virtual image boot process. Is that correct, Jack?
That is correct. There's actually a couple of options for this. On our knowledge base, we have an article that details actually booting into a virtual machine using our rescue media. And then from there, you can restore the image to a virtual disk. But I imagine we'll be talking more about the VI boot feature in the future. But this is just a way to instantly boot up an image. And then, if you want, make changes to it and then create a new image from that.
Okay, thanks, Jack. That's excellent. Jesus, yes, we will be uploading this recording to YouTube. It'll be part of the ongoing series, as I mentioned earlier. All of you ask, how can you tell us? Can you tell us how to restore a disk from an existing image file? I don't know, Jack. Have you got time to quickly show that process? If I hand back the screen to you, because we have
Yeah, I
time.
think this might be worth going into more detail in the future in its own webinar.
Yeah.
But if I can quickly show you the process now,
Okay, I'll make you
and
presenter again.
thank you. So if I cancel out of this backup we just started. So inside Reflect, there's two kind of restores you'll likely be doing. There's restoring to a disk that's not in use and restoring to a disk that is in use by your operating system. So suppose you're restoring to a disk that's currently being used by Windows. You can't perform the restore from within Windows. You'd need to create the rescue media, which can be done through the other task menu here. This allows you to create a bootable USB, ISO, or CD. Once you've booted into that, you'll then be presented with a kind of lightweight version of Reflect in either a PE or RE environment. You can then use the same wizard, which I'm about to show you in a second, to perform the restore to your disk now that you're not actually booted into the operating system. Suppose you want to restore to a disk that's not currently in use by your operating system. You can go to the Restore tab and it will pick up images. But you can select this and it'll be picking up from this destination. You can add more destinations here where images are stored and they'll be added to this list. So once you've got onto here, you can select the image and it'll give you a breakdown of the partitions that are contained again. And then you can select Restore Image, and you can select which disk you want to perform the restore to. So by default, it's showing the disk that I imaged originally, but if I want to restore it to a different location, say the E drive, I can do that, and then select delete the existing partitions on there. And then you can either select copy the selected partitions, which will drag them down onto the disk. But since my secondary disk is larger, I've still got 100 gig of free space left. So what I can do is I can select the last partition on the disk, which is my C drive, and then do restore partition properties. And this will allow me to make use of any of that free space. I select OK and then next. And then once again, you get this information window where it gives you a breakdown of what's going to be happening. It's important here to make sure that you're not overwriting any partitions that are in use or are important to you where you've got data stored. And then if you select finish, the restore will begin.
Okay, thanks for that, Jackie. That's a quick sketch. There's a lot more features built into the restore redeploy
Yeah,
processes,
I think.
which we'll do a future webinar on. I think there's no need
Yeah.
to. Got 5 minutes left,
Hi.
so Jeff, so you asked a question: do you need to change the SID on Windows 10 clones or images? Not if you're using the same licensing information. If you're just, you know, if however though you are going to you reuse the exist the old or the original system, then you'll need to change the SRD, and you do that either through a sys prep before you do a redeploy, or you can redo that. I'm not actually sure you can do it on the cloning process. Jack may be able to help me on that one.
I believe following that, fixed boot problems can resolve any issues relating to that.
Yeah, quite often you may need to, depending on the manufacturer, you may need to rebuild the boot or the rescue partitions, which are were on the original disk, if you're doing a clone. Michael's asking, what is the benefit of using an image instead of a clone? Well, a clone is just straight disk to disk. That's it. You have virtually no options beyond that. For imaging, you have a file which you can redeploy, or you can open up and take out individual files. You can mount it. You can create a virtual machine out of it, et cetera, et cetera. So there's a big difference. Much more flexibility of the image. But sometimes we understand that people want to do a clone if they're just going from an old disk to a new disk. So Roman, you asked a question to migrate from your hard drive to SSD. I assume you're saying the right process would be to clone. Yes, if you're going to be throwing away your old hard drive. Yes, that's correct. What we have, Craig is asking, does backup sets, as in retention rules, include Windows backups contained on the same backup drive? I'm not 100% sure what you mean, but I think what you're saying is if you're using Windows backup and it's storing the information on the same drive, if it's part of any of the partitions which are on the disk or the volume with the disk that you're backing up, then yes, they will be part of that image. That's correct. Roman, your second question, if the volume of the source disk is larger than that of the target disk, will the resizing be done automatically? Yes, provided there's enough space to restore or to clone the data, I assume you're asking, to clone the data from the target. If there's insufficient space to copy the data over, it won't work. So that's the question we have. Great questions. Glad to see that you found this useful. As I said at the start, this has been recorded and we'll be posting it on YouTube along with your questions, because they're all excellent questions. And before we sign off, I just want to say thank you very much to Jack for doing the technical demo. Oh, before we finish, one more question. John is saying, since the clone will not work for me because of sector size differences, can I make a rescue bootable disk? Jack, I think sector size shouldn't matter when it comes to a clone. Is that correct?
I'm not 100%, but I believe if the disks are using a standard sector size, then there shouldn't be any issue. Yeah. We actually have a knowledge base article that relates to this that might be able to provide a bit more information, because I can't remember off the top of my head what the sector sizes are.
Yeah, okay, all right. Interesting. It'd been interesting to know more details on that. I think it'd be worthwhile sending us the question separately. But the second part of the question, can I make a rescue bootable disk and an image disk backup? Restore to the disk using the rescue disk? Yes. The answer is yes. Okay. Well, that's great. Look, thanks again, everyone. I'm going to end the recording now because we've taken 30 minutes of your time. Thanks very much for your attention, and thanks again to Jack. And hopefully you find that useful. Thanks very much, and have a great day.